management of vertigo is a big complex issue which involves pharmacotherapy, that is use of medicines, surgery, physical therapy, that is exercises, and such things together. Today's discussion will be limited to the use of drugs that are used for the management of vertigo. The drugs to be used depend upon whether the patient is having a central vestibular disorder or whether it is a peripheral vestibular disorder. The majority of patients that the clinician sees in his practice are patients suffering from peripheral vestibular disorders. Now, of these patients suffering from peripheral vestibular disorders, some suffer from specific peripheral vestibular disorders like Meniere's disease, vestibular neuronitis, benign paroxysmal positional vertigo, autoimmune vestibular disorder, etc. These patients can definitely be treated by specific medicines which are available for these specific disorders. Like Meniere's disease is best treated by a combination of acetazolamide 250 mg twice daily along with cinnarizine, which may be given at 75 mg thrice daily during the acute stage, followed by a maintenance dose of 25 mg thrice daily, which can continue for about 4 to 6 weeks. Over and above this, for giving some symptomatic relief to the patient, the clinician may add drugs like prochlorperazine and diamine hydronate to control the vertigo, and domperidone or metoclopramide or trifluoprazine for controlling the nausea and the vomiting which accompanies the acute stage of the disease. In some refractory cases, the clinician may have to add steroids, but these are very rare. Another peripheral vestibular disorder, which is quite common in our country, is vestibular neuronitis. Vestibular neuronitis is best treated by a combination of steroids with an antiviral agent like acyclovir. In addition to this, if the patient has severe nausea and vomiting and has uncontrollable vertigo, then the clinician may add some antiemetic agent like metoclopramide and some vestibular sedative like prochlorperazine and diamine hydronate. But usually these are not necessary. Another common specific peripheral vestibular disorder which the clinician encounters in his practice is the benign paroxysmal positional vertigo, the so-called BPPV. There is not much scope of using drugs in this condition. This is best treated by the Epley's maneuver. The other specific peripheral disorders, which are of course not very commonly encountered, are for example, perineal fistula, autoimmune inferior disorder, infective labyrinthitis, etc. Now, if the patient is suffering from a central vestibular disorder or from any of the specific peripheral vestibular disorders, then the treatment is very clear-cut and simple. Unfortunately, however, most patients of vertigo encountered by the clinician in his practice can neither be fitted into any of the specific peripheral vestibular disorders or into the category of central vestibular disorders. It is this group of non-specific vestibular disorders which is difficult to treat because we do not have any idea about the etiology of the condition. But what do we do? So we need to have a specific protocol for managing these cases of non-specific vestibular disorders where we are not sure about the etiology and this height of lesion. Management of non-specific vestibular disorders can be divided into four stages. First is reassurance. Next is the vestibular rehabilitation exercises, that is the physical therapy in the management of vertigo. Next is pharmacotherapy, that is the use of drugs for the treatment of vertigo. And lastly, surgery. Though this presentation is limited to drug therapy of vertigo only, this is in no way to undermine the value of reassuring the patient and the importance of the physical therapy, that is the Cottrell-Cooksey exercises, in the management of a vertigo patient. There are so many drugs available for the treatment of vertigo that the clinician is often at a loss to choose which one to use and which one not to use. So, we must first know what are the objectives that we are expecting from the drug that we are using for the vertigo patient. The objectives of pharmacotherapy are: 1 is to provide symptomatic relief, that is palliative therapy, to reduce the symptom of vertigo and vomiting. Next is to increase the cerebrum and the inner ear blood flow, that is prevent cerebral and inner ear hypoxia. This is necessary because most of the vestibular disorders are known to be caused by hypoxia in the brain and in the inner ear. Increase of active transport through the blood-brain barrier is necessary to maintain the inner ear homeostasis. Next, the drug should be able to improve the neuronal metabolism, that is supply nutrients to the neuronal tissues. Certain neurotransmitters have been found to be effective in the management of vestibular disorders, and stimulation and depression of the relevant neurotransmitters is also a part of pharmacotherapy now. An ideal anti-vertigo drug should serve the following objectives. Namely, it should be able to enhance the cerebral and the inner ear blood flow. It should be reasonably safe. That means it should be free from side effects as much as possible. It should not cause drowsiness. It should not cause CNS depression. It should not have extrapyramidal effects, etc. And finally, it should not in any way depress the vestibular compensatory mechanism. Now, going through our mission of fulfilling the objectives of pharmacotherapy. The first we said was symptomatic treatment, that is palliative therapy, to relieve the patient's symptom of vertigo and vomiting. The symptom of vertigo is best relieved by drugs like cinnarizine, prochlorperazine, dimenhydrinate, meclizine, betahistine, etc. Nausea and vomiting can be controlled by drugs like domperidone, trifluoprazine, metoclopramide, or promethazine. These can be prescribed in the suitable dosage as and when the clinician thinks necessary. The second objective of pharmacotherapy is increasing the cerebral and inner ear blood flow. What is the purpose of enhancing the cerebral and inner ear blood flow? Now, the major known cause of cerebral dysfunction is hypoxia, that is hypoperfusion of the brain. Vestibular labyrinthitis and the neural systems connected with the maintenance of balance are extremely sensitive to hypoperfusion. The neural tissues which are concerned with the maintenance of balance subsist on oxygen and glucose which is carried by the blood. So if there is any hypoperfusion, then there is bound to be degenerative changes in the inner ear and in the brain which will result in disequilibrium. Hypoperfusion will occur if there is any vasoconstriction or vasospasm, if there is any narrowing of the blood vessels due to atherosclerosis, if there is any increased blood viscosity by the aggregation of platelets or by agglutination of the RBCs, and lastly, if there is any damaged endothelium, which will cause improper transfer of nutrients from the blood to the neural tissues. How does one increase the blood flow to the inner ear and the brain? Blood flow to the brain and the inner ear can be enhanced by increasing the cardiac output and inhibiting vasoconstriction in the cerebral blood vessels by drugs like digoxin, propranolol, cinnarizine, etc. Next is by reducing the sludging phenomenon in the blood and the plasma viscosity. This can be done by drugs like cinnarizine, endoxifiline, etc. Another way of increasing the cerebral blood flow is by reducing the erythrocyte rigidity and the thrombocyte agglutination. This is possible by drugs like nectedofuril, cinnarizine, flunarizine, etc. The third objective of pharmacotherapy was to increase the active transport through the blood-brain barrier. This is done by stabilizing the endothelium of the cerebral blood vessels and the nerve cell membrane by drugs like ginkgo biloba, or by preventing the damage to the cell membranes by inhibiting the entry of calcium ions into the cell. This is possible by calcium channel blockers like flunarizine and cinnarizine. The fourth objective of pharmacotherapy was to enhance the neuronal metabolism. This is possible by drugs like pyritinol and piracetam. We are more or less through with the objectives of our therapeutic agents, let us now scan some of the drugs that are commonly used by our clinicians and see the advantages and disadvantages of the various pharmaceutical agents. First, let us go to dimenhydrinate, which is marketed in the name of Gravol or Graminet. Dimenhydrinate, in the dose of 50 milligrams 3 times daily, is very effective in acute vertigo when the patient is having severe vegetative symptoms. Dimenhydrinate inhibits the spread of the hyperactive vestibular input from the vestibular nuclei into the vegetative regulation centers in the reticular formation of the brain. Its antiemetic effect is not associated with any extrapyramidal features, but it is a CNS depressant and it is best used for a very short period only, that is only as long as the patient is having severe nausea, vomiting, palpitation, etc. Diazepam is also a commonly used drug in acute vertigo, but it is best not used because of its CNS depressant effect. CNS depressants will jeopardize the vestibular compensatory mechanism, and hence a drug like diazepam is best avoided in the management of vertigo. Probably one of the commonest drugs prescribed by our clinicians is prochlorperazine. Prochlorperazine is very effective for providing symptomatic relief in patients of acute severe vertigo. However, it is a CNS depressant and is likely to inhibit the vestibular compensatory mechanism. Moreover, it has got some severe side effects like extrapyramidal reaction, hypotension, anticholinergic effects, etc. So it is best used for a very short period of time when the patient is having severe acute vertigo. But as soon as the patient's symptoms come down, this drug should be discontinued. Next is cinnarizine. Cinnarizine is probably the commonest drug that our clinicians rely on treating a patient of vertigo. It serves many purposes. One, it has got a very good labyrinthine sedative effect, that is, it provides symptomatic relief to the patient. It has got a good anti-vasoconstrictive effect, which prevents hypoxia and hypoperfusion in the brain. It reduces the sludging phenomenon of blood in the narrow arterioles which supply the inner ear and the brain, and hence by decreasing the viscosity of the blood, it stabilizes the vascular endothelium, and what is most important, it is a reasonably safe antivertigo drug. It does not have any significant side effects. The labyrinthine sedative effect of cinnarizine, which is responsible for the palliative therapy, that means for providing symptomatic relief to the patient, is due to its calcium channel blocking property. The depolarization of the neural cells in the vestibular labyrinth increases the influx of calcium ions. Cinnarizine prevents the calcium ion influx into the vestibular sensory cells and thereby prevents the depolarization of these cells. The net result of this is reduced irritability of the vestibular labyrinth and hence reduced vertigo. Cinnarizine, by inhibiting the entry of calcium ions into the RBCs, increases the deformability of the RBCs, thereby facilitating its passage through the narrow arterioles of the inner ear and the cerebral tissues. By this way, cinnarizine prevents any stagnation of blood in the narrow arterioles, and this prevents any hypoperfusion in the brain. Last but not the least is the safety profile of cinnarizine. It is a very, very safe drug. It does not have any severe extrapyramidal reactions like the phenothiazines. It is not contraindicated in peptic ulcer and bronchial asthma like betahistine. It is not a CNS depressant like diazepam, and hence it does not jeopardize the vestibular compensatory mechanism. Though betahistine has been claimed to be a totally non-sedating antivertigo drug, a study by Clausen et al., published in the International Journal of Clinical Pharmacology, has established beyond doubt that the effect on vigilance of cinnarizine does not significantly differ from that of betahistine in a double-blind, randomized clinical trial involving a very large group of patients. Now let us see, how does cinerizine compare with an ideal antivitiligo drug? Cinerizine increases the blood flow in the cerebral tissues and the inner ear by its antihypertensive action and by its effect of reduction of plasma viscosity by enhancing the deformability of RBCs. It is a reasonably safe drug and it is not known to jeopardize the vestibular compensatory mechanism. All these facts add up together to make cinerizine the ideal antivitiligo drug. Betahistine is also quite a popular antivitiligo drug. It also increases the inner ear blood flow and has got some amount of vasodilating property. But it has got some side effects, like it is known to induce bronchospasm and cannot be used in peptic ulcer patients. This was a brief overview on the pharmacotherapy of vitiligo. However, clinicians should remember that it is not drugs only which can take care of your vitiligo patients. Physical therapy, that is the Cottrell-Cook's exercises, and your reassurance should always be there when you are treating a patient of vitiligo. Thank you.
Responsibility is to doctors, nurses, and patients.